My next guest is the lead singer of one of the biggest country music bands of the 90s. From their meager beginnings in Muscle Shoals to becoming Grammy, ACM, and CMA award winners, they have 13 number one hits, 26 charted singles on the Billboard Hot Country charts, and over 1 million albums sold worldwide. Welcome to Hayes' Hard Drive from the band Shenandoah, one of the most recognizable voices in the business, Mr. Marty Raybon. How you doing, bud?
Man, I'm doing great. Dave, you doing good, pal?
Man, I'm doing great. As I told you before we came on, man, this is just a treat for me. You've been playing on my radio for as long as I can remember, and I'm just excited to get a chance to talk to you today.
I guarantee it's my pleasure.
Now, Marty, you grew up in Muscle Shoals, Alabama, and I know that music was something that was a big part of your life. I know, you know, your dad had a bluegrass band, the American Bluegrass Express, and so that was something that's always been a part of your life.
Yeah, you know, and it really actually had started from the early days of when my dad and his brothers had played and sang together, and so therefore, anytime there was any type of ever family function or family reunion or anything like that, you know, we would always. Man, music would literally inundate the day.
The band's second album, The Road Not Taken, had three consecutive number one hits: The Church on Cumberland Road, Sunday in the South, and Two Dozen Roses. When you guys cut these in the studio, did you have any idea the success this album would have?
I tell you what we did feel, you know, we really truly felt like, you know, we had the kind of stuff, coming off of, She Doesn't Cry Anymore, which was our first top 10 record. And then Mama Knows followed that at 4. And then here came Church on Cumberland Road. That was off the Road Not Taken album, and the next thing you know, man, here comes Sunday in the South, and then Two Dozen Roses, and we had just kind of felt like, you know, we really actually had found a vein, or found a passage through what it seemed like the country music listener at that time was really digging, and it was a real exciting time. Now, did we know that it would yield such success? No, I don't think anybody knows it. But the reason why you do it is because you believe it will, and that's, you know, that's what we went into. We really believed that it would really do what we kind of felt like it did.
Well, you know, I was reading an interesting fact about the Church on Cumberland Road. With it had a 2-week run at number one, and that actually marked the first time in country music history that a country music's band first number one single spent more than 1 week at the top. That's something I didn't. I mean, that's amazing with the country music band legacy that preceded you guys. You guys were the first one to do that. That's a really big accolade.
And that again. You know, was something that, you know, that during the process, D, we didn't recognize that either. In fact, to be honest with you, man, there was so many things going on in our career at that time. You know, here we were in the throes of this and records happening, and man, our heads kind of spinning, you know, from all the things that the record labels got us doing and going here and going there and doing this and doing that. You know, and a lot of those things that actually would have been really, really nice to know or nice to hear about during that time, you know, had really, you know, went right past us. And to other people, it didn't seem as important. It literally was only after the fact that we had learned a lot of those things.
Well, you know, it's just so interesting. The you know, in looking back in retrospect at something, you understand the, you know, just the enormity of what had just taken place, you know, and all the stuff that had gone on. I'm sure it was just really quick, really fast. And, you know, it was almost like, oh my goodness, we didn't even know what hit you.
It really was. I mean, it kind of come on us, and, You know, and it really kind of left the same way. It was kind of like a perfect storm that came in and a perfect storm that went out. And it really was. I mean, it honest and truly was. It was great, and it was wonderful to realize only after the fact of what all had happened. You know, I mean, just like now as we're having conversation, we'd be doing an interview with Bob Kingsley or somebody. Go, you know, now you know that.
Absolutely, yeah.
Such and such as, you know, this and that, and you guys were the ones that didn't get to, and we just kind of looked at each other and go, I didn't, did you know that? No, I didn't know that either. And so therefore, but when it's all over with, said and done, you know, a lot of people tell you that they're not in it for the success and all that kind of stuff. I'll be honest with you, we were. And the reason why we were is because we loved doing what we did, and we have a lot of fun doing what we do. And you know, honest and truly, where a lot of people want to share music, and I don't want anybody to get this wrong, so I want to explain it the best I can. Now, we love making great records, and that's what we try to do. We try our best to make the best record that we can absolutely make, and because we want folks to like it, and we want folks to like what we're doing and stuff, but we also take as much strategy and as much, you know, trying and as much effort is trying to get folks to enjoy a show as them going to see anybody. So therefore, we spend a great deal of time on trying to entertain people. Look, you know, most of the time we get hired for 90 minutes or 2 hours, whatever it is. And at that point, when we get hired, we're working for a promoter or a buyer. Well, once you pull up on the grounds, you no longer work for that buyer anymore. Now, under contract, you do. But at that point, when you step off the bus, you belong to the public. And from that point on, all the way through the show, you know, them folks came, they spent their hard-earned dollar. Man, you know, they just want to get to know you. You know, they just want to say howdy with you. They just want to rub elbows with you. They want to know that you're real. They're real. They want to know that you're real, too. And we just never felt like, you know, it was ever a good thing to try to beat anybody out of that.
That is very refreshing to hear. And, I mean, you know, even us as fans, you know, that's... You know, you guys have, you know, I don't know how much the fan knows how much you guys have been through as a band. You know, just to, for instance, just to keep the name Shenandoah, you know, it was something. I mean, I think the band name was like, here's a couple of suggestions. You guys pick one. And then, you know, after all that, having to go through all the legality because this band's named Shenandoah and all that stuff like that. And I mean, how in the world did you guys kind of go through all of that? And then on the other end of it, Marty, you guys were still making number one hits. I mean, did that bring you guys together going through, you know, that situation?
Yeah, you know, I think any time, you know, it's well, I tell you, man, here's a great example or a great scenario. Not really so great for our country because it was a tragic day. But I remember on 9/11, literally how a Republican and a Democrat, an independent, a lover and a hater came together that day.
Absolutely.
They realized the value of literally what we had was way above the pettiness. And that was really kind of how we were about everything that was going on. Look, we were not the ones that picked the name. We were given a choice, as you said, between the Rhythm Rangers and Shenandoah. Now, D, which one would you pick?
you know what? I completely agree with you with the Rhythm Rangers. It sounds like it's some subpar group that, you know, you're probably going to be playing the local nightclub and maybe some apartment complexes.
Yeah, you know, the old fish camp and barbecue tour.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, but anyway, so, you know, that what you're talking about, and for the public, they were three different names groups that were named Shenandoah that literally could prove in a court of law that they had the name before we did. And what had happened was the record label and the production company that we were signed with, they gave us the two names to pick with, and they wanted Shenandoah is what they wanted. That's the reason why they came with the Rhythm Rangers. And but the only bad thing about it was is they didn't do a trademark search. Now, you would think a conglomerate.
Of course.
CBS Records would have done a trademark search, but they didn't.
That's common sense.
And before it was all over with, I mean, it come down to it. And to be honest with you, when all these acts started coming against us and stuff, you know, we even asked the question, well, wait a minute. Now, how in the world can this group in Massachusetts and this group in Las Vegas and this group in Kentucky, how in the world can they play under the name Shenandoah, but we can't? And this is what the judge said. The judge said, well, the thing about it is you're not impeding the business of the group in Massachusetts if you had a stayed in Massachusetts. Vice versa, the same thing in Las Vegas, Nevada, and the same thing in Louisville, Kentucky. But when your records became national and they became nationwide, therefore, you started infringing on their business, and that's why.
You know.
So the more popular we got, the more we got hammered.
You know, speaking.
But, you know, again, the question was asked: did it bring us together? And absolutely, yes, it did. And probably closer than we'd ever been, because we realized that you know that what folks were after, you know, really wasn't us. It was a name that was given to us. It wasn't us. It wasn't us personally. The only thing we knew to do was, hey, look, man, strike another chord, find another stage, and let's get on with it.
Well, you know, I think, you know, when you're talking about going through these things and you know, the rigors of being on the road and there's something about your music, something about the band's music and the way you've selected things, the way you've written things. I've always felt that you always, when you recorded, you always had a story or a message, and there was something wholesome about the product that Shenandoah put out. There was never a song that had any type of, you know, negative connotation, any type of, you know, kind of, oh, this is a little sketchy song. There was always a story, always something that made you feel good or feel something. Is this something, Marty, that you guys have done on purpose in the way that you guys select or write your music?
Yeah, you know, it really is, because, you know, we never wanted to, you know, we never wanted to promote drinking and carrying on and cheating and running around on your wife and you know, broken homes and all. Look, now I know all of that is reality, and we all get that, and we don't live in a fairy tale world. I mean, we honestly and truly live in Realville, USA. I mean, we really do. But the thing about it is when there's so many other good things, you know, that you can sing about and make people feel good about. Again, I go back to what I was telling you a while ago about trying to entertain people. You know, at the end of the day, the verdict is whether we entertain the crowd or not. You know, whether they heard the song or not, we're going to play the song, because that's what we were contracted to do. But what we wanted to do was, at the end of the evening, is we actually wanted, because of the songs and the selection of the songs and the story of the songs and being able to move people up and down, you know, even in a live setting, that at the end of the day, if we got them involved and we got them hooping and hollering and cheering and that kind of stuff, and at the end of 90 minutes or 2 hours, however long we were playing, at the end of the evening, then folks realized that they were a part of a show instead of sitting and witnessing one.
Well, you know, I will tell you this, my own personal experience. I know every word to this very next song. I had a little, as we talked about before, one of those little bands that played the apartment complexes and the little, you know, little side gigs as a high school kid. And I sang this song right here multiple times off of the album that we had talked about before, The Road Not Taken. It's Two Dozen Roses, and we'll be right back with more from Marty Raybon right here on Hayes' Hard Drive.
I brought flowers to your door last night. I done you wrong and I wanna make it right. You say I'm not welcome here. I know it ought to be perfectly clear, but I can't help but wonder what it might be like. If I had two dozen roses and an old bottle of wine, if I really could have hung the moon, would it change your mind? If I could cry a little harder and get a little less sleep at night, if I had two dozen roses, would it change your mind? You can't have again. I've done all that I know to do and second guess my every move. I can't help but wonder how it might have been if I had two dozen roses and an old bottle of wine. If I really
talking with the lead singer of Shenandoah, Marty Raybon, and you rejoined the band in 2014 after a 17-year hiatus. How was that, you know, getting back together with the band after so long?
To tell you the truth, it was really kind of, it was kind of like, you know, as they say, riding a bicycle. You jump back on there and go to pedaling, but I don't know. Somebody asked me one day what I thought about it, and I said, man, it's like a glove on a rooster. I mean, it just kind of fit. And when it did, it just kind of seemed like everything was in a good place. And you know, since then, you know, some of the, to be honest with you, the mathematical probability of being able to share with everybody today with you, about some of the wonderful things that's happened. I mean, we just wouldn't have time if we did a 2-hour radio spot. It's just, man, it's been good. It's literally been the providence of God that things have been what they've been. And for us to be as fortunate as what we have, and what we've done is we come back with a happy heart to find that there was a lot of folks out there that still wanted to hear what we had done years ago. And man, that's an awfully, awfully good feeling today. It sure is.
Well, you know, you guys are on the 30th anniversary tour, and you've had to extend the tour. Like you just said, people are wanting to hear you. You're packing out your shows. Popular demand. Now, on top of that, you released Reloaded in March of 2018, and that features a lot of the greatest hits live. But you guys have three songs on there that is your first new music in 20 years. How was that getting back in the studio, producing new music with the guys?
Oh, man, that was real exciting. Jay DeMarcus with the group Rascal Flatts was producing, and that was really exciting to be able to do that. You know, them guys are big fans of ours as they were coming up, and we were big fans of theirs as well too. And to be able to collaborate and to be able to put that together and to be able to work together and stuff like that was really a great experience to be able to be part of that.
Well, I know that I personally really appreciate your time today. I know you have a lot going on as well as other interviews, and you're out on tour, and we are really looking forward to your North Carolina stop here on October the 19th in Liberty. And I just thank you so much for taking the time out today to make this this old North Carolinian's day. I really appreciate it.
Well, brother, I can tell you, I sure appreciate your time too. And man, just literally can't wait till we get up there to Liberty. Man, that's some good friends of ours, good people. Hey, them old Tar Heels up there, buddy. Hey, good folk.
Yeah, hey, you know what? As Charlie told me, he's still got a whole lot of tar on his heels, and you know what? That's we're just good old people here, you know, in the old North State, and we're just looking forward to seeing you. And, you know, this next song that I'm going to play for him, Marty, I believe you had a hand in writing this after you guys, this is what's great about this song. You guys saw a commercial for line dancing instructions.
Yeah.
And you know what? If Bubba can dance, apparently I can too. This is Delane Hayes. You're listening to Hayes' Hard Drive, and we've been talking with Marty Raybon from Shenandoah.